Hi, I'm Jim Maisano, and this is the Westchester Consumer Report. As you probably know, for 21 years, I served as a county legislator representing New Rochelle and Pelham in District 11. But as of February 26, I took a new position. I was appointed to be the Consumer Protection Director for Westchester County, and that is the job I now have, and there'll be a special election to have a new county legislator for District 11. But since my new position is Consumer Protection Director for Westchester County, the first show we're going to tape for my cable TV show as Consumer Protection Director is all about the department. Today we're going to talk all the nuts and bolts, what the Westchester County Consumer Protection Department does for the people of Westchester. And my special guest is John Gassione. John, say hello.
Hi, Jim. Thanks for having me.
I'm happy to have you. John is a 32-year employee of the Westchester County Consumer Protection Department. He is the sealer under the county charter, and he's the deputy director. We work together each day finding ways to protect the people of Westchester from a consumer protection perspective, and it's fabulous for me as the new director for only a month and a half to have somebody as the deputy who has 32 years of experience.
Thanks so much, Jim. And you're sort of stepping in the role running already, feet hitting the ground, in that a lot of the work you did as a legislator was constituent work, helping people solve problems.
Right. So I've been telling, so a lot of people say, what's the new job like? And I tell them one of the greatest parts of the job is that when I was a county legislator, one of my favorite parts was helping people, as you were describing.
Right.
Finding ways, when someone calls the office and they need a little help, finding a way to help them. Well, that's what consumer protection does all day long.
Right.
So I'm now performing all week long in this new position as consumer protection director, the best part of my legislative job. So I'm having a lot of fun with that and learning about all the different phases of the office. We really do have a terrific office. Some people have asked, what was your initial reaction to working at the Consumer Protection Department? I said, the first thing I realized was we have a terrific staff there.
Well, thanks. Thanks so much, Jimmy. We do appreciate it. Everyone does come to work to help people. Sometimes we have good days, sometimes we have bad days, but the effort is there and we're trying to help people and we're trying to prevent people from becoming the victims of scams and other unfortunate acts.
Absolutely. So let's go through to answer the question that people watching the show are going to want to ask. What does the Westchester County Consumer Protection do? And maybe we'll go into three segments if we can.
Sure.
We can talk about the licensing piece of the office, mm-hmm. where we license contractors, whether it's home improvement contractors, which includes landscapers, we have the plumbers, and we have the electricians. That's right. One piece. And then we could talk about complaints.
Sure.
Consumer complaints. And then we can go into your expertise. As I always tell people, I'm lucky to have a director who's one of the experts in New York State on weights and measures. So let's handle those three if we may. So let's start with the licensing process for Westchester County.
Sure, Jim, and thank you for the compliment. Yeah, we license what we call the trades, the electricians, plumbers, and home repair contractors, home improvement contractors. So three different types of licenses. The plumbers and electricians have appointed boards. The County Executive Latimer appoints members to the board based on their expertise. One is an electrical engineer, one owns a electrical business, another one is an educator in the union, so different types. And they set policy, but we administer it for them. So they give a license, there's a test, you need XYZ qualifications to take that test, so many years in the industry. And the plumbing board is very similar. There is a board, it's appointed by the county executive. They make policy, they set up a set of minimum standards to be a plumber. And so that, and the home repair contractors, we have a little more control over in that yourself and I are the final say on who gets a license and who doesn't. So we license the home repair contractors or home improvement contractors too. Now the numbers that go with that, there's 8,000 licensed home repair contractors, and that includes the landscapers, which you mentioned. About 1,500 or so licensed electricians, and probably a little less, maybe around 1,000 or so licensed plumbers. They don't all reside in Westchester, but you need the license to work in Westchester. Right. And we also handle complaints about them, and we'll talk a little bit more about the complaints a little later on.
Well, that's great. So, the license process, let's start with the home improvement contractors, which covers contractors going to make repairs to a house or landscape, mm-hmm. Landscapers. What are the type of problems they can have when they apply for a license?
Sure. We do a background check. We will check the county's criminal justice database. We will check the county clerk's records for judgments, liens, claims against them. We will check our complaint database. If they have a license in another county, we may or may not, depending on what we find ourselves, contact that other county to see if they were problematic there, or if there's a reason why they don't have a license in their home county. If they were from Rockland or Putnam, how come you don't have a license where your business is? That, you know, that sort of sets off a bell. So we take the time to do that. We also do, like everybody else, a Google search. You'd be surprised what you find on the internet.
That's for sure. You'd be surprised what you find on the Google, as we call it at home.
Right, the Google, right. So we do that, and then based on that, it takes us about 30 days to turn it around. We'll issue or deny a license.
So what would be a trigger to cause someone to lose their license or not get approved for a license?
Sure. A pattern of unpaid judgments, whether by consumers or state, federal, or local agencies. There to us, someone's A, not financially responsible, or B, is just ignoring what they should be doing, the taxes they should be paying, whether it's sales tax, unemployment tax, all those types, federal tax, all those types of things. So they have an opportunity to be heard. They can go before a hearing officer. He makes a recommendation. And then we decide based on that recommendation and any other evidence we can collect, you know, whether to grant the license or deny it.
So let's go off on a position that, as you know, since the day I arrived about a month and a half ago, we've discussed several times now. One priority I would like to have at the office is as close as possible to a zero tolerance for unlicensed contractors in Westchester County. And I think it's important to note, as you were just laying out the background check, why it's so important that we have a license process in Westchester County. We want the people of Westchester, when they need to hire a contractor, to be able to hire someone that's safe, someone that's been vetted, right, someone that's been checked. These people are going to go inside somebody's home.
Correct.
So it's critically important that we do the licensing process, which is why, as we've discussed, and I know something you want as well, that we should have a zero tolerance of anybody operating as a contractor in Westchester County who doesn't have that license.
Sure, sure. What we plan to do and go forward with is we will have sting operations. Our investigators will go out in the field. They will make stops. Anybody that's a licensed contractor has a bumper sticker, and it has an expiration date on it, and it has a serial number on it, which we can trace back to that company and to the vehicle that belongs to that company. So there's a process out there. We will be out in the field, especially this time of year, and in other times of the year also. We do that. We also check advertisements. When we have the opportunity, we will check for ads. There's less and less print ads and more web ads, but we do look at ads also to see if they're licensed or not. And a licensed contractor will have his license number in that ad. It's important to remember. So we're going to be stepping up enforcement, reallocate some of the resources, get some additional resources, get the cooperation of some of the local towns and villages, their building inspectors. We make their local PDs aware of it, especially for vagabonds and travelers,
right,
those types of businesses that just swarm in.
Right. And we're planning to work closer with the county police.
Right.
They're going to be an ally to us on this.
Right. Effort. The Department of Public Safety has always been very good to us, and they're going to, and to my understanding, things are going to remain the same, which is great. So, so it all works together.
Yeah, I mean, I took this concern even as a legislator, and it's not just for the Consumer Protection Department, but it's for all our different aspects of the county government. You know, I always believed if there's a licensing process, and some companies, some contractors are playing by the rules, they're getting their background check, they're paying their fee, they're doing everything right, they should not have to compete against contractors that didn't follow the rules. Someone is breaking the law. It's not a fair marketplace to the people that did the right
thing.
Sure.
We strive for a fair marketplace. That's really the big theme behind our office. We want to protect people from unscrupulous merchants and at the same time ensure a level playing field or a fair marketplace in that everyone has the opportunity for the same items at the same price or the same service at the same price or a fair price.
Right. So if you're watching our show today and you are holding yourself out in Westchester County as a contractor, landscaping, home improvement contractor, and you're doing work, just so you know, we're looking for you.
Sure.
If you don't have your license, our office is going to be looking for you. You better get down to that our office and get your license as soon as possible.
Sure.
Because we're going to be aggressively enforcing the law this year against unlicensed contractors. As John said, we're going to put resources into it, and we're going to be pretty aggressive about it.
Yeah, sure. For a number of years, we've done these programs. We're going to continue it now, but we're going to bring it up to the next level.
Great. Super. All right. So that's a good segue. So we talked about unlicensed contractors. It's a good segue into consumer complaints.
Sure.
We have a consumer protection code for Westchester County. It's a law that's been around for decades, and we are the ones that administer and enforce the consumer protection code. Why don't you give some people some background on the Consumer Protection Code?
Sure, sure. It really started going back really to the mid-1970s. The department sort of rolled out of a Department of Weights and Measures. And they added to that and made a consumer department, and that really became all-encompassing. We have a complaint procedure. We have a number of local consumer laws that address visibility of cash registers, pricing, refund policy, sell-by dates. So there's a number of things that are written into that code, which is unique to Westchester, which is a credit to Westchester. So all of those different things come into play. But the code really, it says protect the consumer, ensure what we talked about, a fair and equitable marketplace, but it also includes a complaint procedure and remedies for consumers who've been wronged. So we have a complaint procedure. Anyone can file a complaint if they felt like they've been wronged by a vendor. It doesn't just have to be someone here in Westchester. If you're a non-Westchester resident and the vendor's here, we probably will take a look at your complaint also. But you can complain. We just ask that you give us details, provide receipts, paperwork, whatever you have. And remember now with the internet, things, emails you may have, where traditionally we used to ask for the cash register receipt. Well, people don't have those anymore. They get them emailed. You know, the technology has changed that, but there still is some type of trail, paper trail, electronic trail. We need those documents. We're going to look to see if there's any violations of our consumer code, like some of them I mentioned. We will bring that to the attention of the vendor and say, look, we have someone here that's been wronged or possibly wronged. Is there a way we can mediate or settle this? We noticed that X, Y, and Z is wrong with your contract, or you violated law this one, that one, or the other one.
When you say notice, you serve?
We will bring it to their attention either by mail or by phone. We don't want to start an enforcement action if the vendor is ready to comply, has admitted that, you know, yes, we made a mistake, we will take care of the consumer, and we'll end that practice, whatever it may be. Sometimes it's something as simple as not having a refund policy posted. The law says every merchant has to have a refund policy posted near the point of sale. So the point is, we want to get the consumer whole. We'll use what we have in the consumer code. We will bring it to the attention of the vendor. Look, we can sort of put these aside. If I get a call from the consumer, they're very happy, they're satisfied, and they felt like everything went in their direction. Right. So we use our discretion.
Right, and that's important, right? Because we don't want to be anti-business. We don't want to be harming small businesses in Westchester. We just want them to follow the law.
Sure, sure. We want, you know, we keep talking about level and equal and equality, and that really is what we're striving for. Certainly, I mean, everybody along the way makes a mistake. It's when we start to see patterns of mistakes that we need to start to take enforcement action.
So give a couple of examples of the typical consumer complaint, something you've seen a lot of. A lot of times, this particular activity leads to a consumer complaint.
Towing, overcharging, towing from private lots. We have a county law that says you can charge X amount of dollars for the tow and then X amount of dollars for each additional mile and then a overnight storage fee. Well, for a while, a lot of towing companies were charging whatever they wanted, and that includes booting, too. That's a little different than towing, but the initial fee is the same. We're towing, and then we would get a complaint that from someone saying they were charged X amount of dollars, which was way above what was allowable, and then we started to see pattern, and we started to see it at certain places, and then we saw also that where those parking lots were, there was no signage. There needs to be a sign to say, you're parked here, you can park here 2 hours, 3 hours, whatever the case. Excuse me. XYZ is going to tell you if you're here longer than that, and this is how you can contact them.
Right, right. I've certainly, as a legislator, we got complaints
sure.
about the towing industry, so I understand that very, very well. And again, so if you got evidence in a consumer complaint that a particular tow company wasn't following the law, the first thing you do is put them on notice and bring them in and mediate to see if you can find some kind of solution.
Right. It might not even involve a visit to the office. We can work by phone. We can work by email. If we see a pattern, we're going to cite them. We're going to give them we're going to write what we call an appearance ticket. They're going to have to come to a settlement conference at the office. A penalty may be assessed. We're going to need restitution for the consumer. We're going to need everything corrected. If they decide they don't want to do that, we will send them before an administrative law judge. And then whatever that judge finds, that will be the penalty. He may order restitution. A lot of things work behind the scenes, so sometimes we don't really get that far. But the idea is, come on, we need to straighten this out.
So those are the steps. So the first is kind of a mediation process where they, either by phone or often in person, they'll come in, we'll try to find a solution to the consumer complaint.
Sure.
If we can't come to a solution there, it gets sent to a hearing officer. The hearing officer reviews all the evidence and makes a decision and sends the decision back to us to make a final decision.
Right, yeah, that's part of what we do, yeah. So we really call it a settlement conference, and if we can't work it out at the settlement conference, okay, let's push it on to a formal hearing, or the possibility exists in about 5 to 7% of our complaints fall into this category that they're not valid. That, you know, you might have somebody parking where they shouldn't have been and didn't see the sign, but it was there. You know, a lot of it involves legwork too. Our inspector may go to the location if it's a retailer, or may go to the company if it involves towing. So,
well, that's
a lot of different
things.
Well,
that's an important part of the equation.
Sure.
Let me jump into that. So what our office does in the course of dealing with these consumer protection complaints is we have inspectors.
Correct.
We have inspectors that do all different jobs in our office. Tell about the job of an inspector that's dealing with consumer complaints.
Sure, we have two veteran inspectors right now that are handling that. And basically what they'll do is they'll review the complaint, they'll try to get all the paperwork they can, reach out to the vendor, fax it to it, send it to them, email it to them. You know, we thank God for the new technology, it really speeds things along. It may involve a site visit. The inspector may go out, and let's say it's the refund policy or the totalizer on the register, you can't see it as it's being rung up, which it drives me crazy. But
sure.
They'll go and do a visual inspection,
right?
Write a report.
Which happened about a week ago.
Right.
I had an experience.
Right.
My wife was away. I was feeding my son and I, so I ordered some food online. And we had to send an inspector to the store because their website regarding paying by credit card online wasn't very clear.
Right.
So we sent an inspector to the site, again, not looking to fine anybody.
No.
Not looking to hurt a business, but making sure a business complies with the law, even beyond that, just making sure that a business is being fair with consumers when they go to the website.
Yeah, the other part of the equation is that if someone complains about something or business practice like that, there's probably two or three other people that are not complaining about that business practice. So it's not just that one individual that we're taking care of. We're changing the business practice. And that,
right.
And so down the line, people are...
And let's talk about the third phase. So if one of these consumer complaints goes to a hearing officer, if they don't like the decision that the hearing officer arrived at and sent to us to make a final decision. If they don't like that final decision, they can do what's called an Article 78 proceeding and go into the Supreme Court and have a Supreme Court judge review the case.
Exactly.
So if you're accused of a consumer protection complaint, it's a very fair process.
Sure.
From this beginning phase, which is settlement, we try to settle. Then we go to the hearing officer. Then they can go to court. So it's a pretty fair process.
Yeah. I think you hit the nail right on the head when you said it's not about collecting the fines. It's about getting it right for the consumer and then ensuring that the marketplace is fair.
Right. All right, so let's just toss in one thing we did.
Sure.
Kind of in the consumer protection realm is when we had those recent storms, the County Executive Latimer's office wanted us to take a look at things like price gouging.
Sure.
So when we had those storms, two areas where not only do we independently research, but we actually did get some complaints, or some of the complaints we heard about were on Facebook.
Right.
Shows how times have changed, right? People were complaining on Facebook, number one, that hotels were double or tripling their rates during the power outages.
Right.
And the other thing we got, which we always get, is gas stations are raising the price of gas. So we One thing that you and I spoke about in the middle of that first storm about a month ago, that we immediately decided we were going to put two inspectors in the field. This was on a Sunday night we spoke. Mm. On a Monday, for the whole Monday, we have two inspectors in the field that did nothing but inspect all the gas stations
right.
and make sure there's no price gouging with right. gas stations.
Yeah, we went to areas that were hardest hit by the storm, and then we expanded it to the whole county to see if prices were out of whack from what they were a week or 10 days ago. And fortunately, we didn't really see any price gouging. And it's funny, we were being contacted by other agencies for the data that we collected. Did you find anything? What happened? So really, we were fortunate in that we didn't really see A, an interruption in supply, and B, a lot of stations offline because of the storm. So prices stayed pretty stable.
Yeah, we were encouraged by our investigation that
right.
we did, that,
these, right.
that the gas stations really weren't gouging.
Well, what happened was the day that we went out, the word was out that we were looking.
Spreads.
So there was probably a lot of prevention there
right.
also.
Well, and that's part of the, you know, the very fact that we have inspectors in the field reviewing situations in Westchester make sure that the word gets out that we're out in the field, and it causes businesses to follow the law.
Yeah.
It's a deterrence.
The vendors see the truck pull up. Okay.
Yes.
Is it a regular inspection, or are they here for a particular reason? So,
right. So the place we might have found more evidence of gouging during the storms with the hotels. We got phone calls. We did due diligence. It was hard to figure out exactly what the hotels were doing. It did look like a few of them raised their prices. Was it unconscionable under the state gouging laws is an open question.
Right.
But we did make phone calls.
Sure.
We did aggressively pursue. In some cases, we went to the hotels.
Yeah, we went to two or three locations.
And had conversations with them.
Right.
And from what I could tell, the best I could tell in my own review is the new director. Again, that point was in the office for about 10 days. But any hotel that we thought was raising the prices immediately knocked them down
right.
when we started our investigation. And then word got out in the industry and nobody was
right.
Raising their prices too much during the storm. So that was good work.
Yeah, sure. I put a face to the department.
Yes.
You know, we could broadcast and say a lot of things, but when someone goes there in person, the vendor or the retailer has a totally different spin on things.
Right. Well, that's some great work by our office. I was impressed about my 10th day with our team. Okay. So let's go to part three of our office, something that you have tons of experience. I know you go around the state at times and speak at conferences on it and a real expert on it. And it's such an important part of the county government consumer protection world. It's really the founding part, as you describe.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's weights and measures. And I want to just for the people at home, explain how weights and measures has been part of our country since Thomas Jefferson and Abraham Lincoln.
Right.
And going back, Ben Franklin.
Sure, sure. Actually, it was John Adams, second president, that passed the first weights and measures law. And back then, the idea was a Connecticut bushel was different than a New York bushel, than a Massachusetts bushel when it came to wheat or some other grain that was being sold. So they needed to standardize everything and make it the same. So a gallon in New Rochelle is the same as a gallon in Cortland, is the same as a gallon in Somer. So, but the department, there was always a division of weights and measures, and actually in New York State, it goes back to the mid-1800s. And the idea behind the department and the state mandate is that every weighing and measuring device used in retail or commercial trade needs to be tested to be accurate once a year.
And the theory is, speaking as my old legislative hat, if you spend a dollar on gasoline, you get a dollar's worth of gasoline.
Right, right. Equal. Very, very simple and equal process. Yes. Equality in the marketplace that, yeah, a gallon in New Jersey is the same as a gallon in New York is the same as a gallon in Montana.
Right. So two of the areas where we have guys in the field literally every day
mm-hmm.
Is inspecting for weights and measures. Gas stations
right.
and retail stores. Those
right.
seem to be the most of the work
sure.
of our inspectors.
Sure.
Why don't you explain what our inspectors do when they're out in the field?
Sure. If it's inspecting a gas station, yes, they're checking to make sure it's a true gallon. They are also checking the pricing. They are also checking the grade of gasoline. They are taking samples. Not every station, but we randomly do that in that if it's an 87 octane, if it's regular, it's sent off to a lab to be tested.
Right. And the signage, too.
Right. Street signs, price signs on top, we call them toppers, on top of the pumps.
Right, and they have to do cash and credit, right?
Right. If a station does what we call two-tier pricing, they have to show both on top of the pump. We found actually now because the price is below $3, that there's less and less of the two-tier pricing, which is good, because then when you pull in, you know, you kind of, am I using my debit card? Am I using my credit card? Am I paying cash? So that's been good. They also take the pump apart, and this is the most interesting spin on it, to check for skimmers.
I went, as you took me right. In the field to watch our inspectors in action. I was so impressed with how they opened up the machine to see if there was a skimmer inside the gas pump that was stealing the credit card information.
Yeah, the skimmer could be very quickly placed in a gas pump. Anybody driving by fills up, you swipe your card, it recorded the information for the magnetic strip on your card, and then within a matter of minutes, it's transposed and sent to some scamster somewhere, and they're producing a new card with that card information.
Okay, so let's turn quickly. We have about a minute left. Quickly tell us about what happens when they go into the grocery stores or inspectors and weights and measures.
Sure, so they're checking the scales, which is about 40 to 45, depending on the size of the store. Some stores have more, some have less. They're checking the scales, they're checking the scanners to make sure they're accurate. They're checking the package weights on items that are produced in the store, you know, the meat case and those types of things. And they're checking the dating, especially in the dairy case, to make sure there's items not past their sale date.
So important. Yeah. That is such an important part of what we do.
Westchester's unique in that they have a dating law for what they call easily perishable items, which to me is dairy products.
Right. That's very important. So we have our inspectors are in our grocery stores in particular, checking the scales, checking the scanners, making sure people aren't getting ripped off by a grocery store. The good news is we find most times they are complying with the law, but there are deviations that we need to find them for every now and then.
Sure. I mean, you have to understand that the retailer, especially in the supermarket industry, they're working on a very small markup. They're not going to do anything. And with social media now, if one person finds one thing wrong,
sure,
it's out there within a matter of minutes.
All right. So, John, we're going to close with that thought on your specialty weights and measures. Thank you so much for coming in today. Thank you all for all you've done for Westchester County for 32 years. It's been a lot of fun for a month and a half to work with you, and we're going to do great things moving forward.
Thanks so much, Jim. I appreciate it.
Thank you. So thank you for tuning in to the Westchester Consumer Report. If you need to contact the Westchester County Consumer Protection Department, the number is 914-995-2155, or you can even email us at conpro@westchestergov.com. I'm Jim Maisano. This is the Westchester Consumer Report. Thanks for tuning in.